But first, some background on Dan. He's a North Hill guy, earned degrees from both Kent State and the University of Akron. Very politically correct. I'm very uncomfortable calling him Dan. I constantly call him Mayor, and he says, no, call me Dan. I feel he earned the title Mayor and should have it, but today, since you've insisted, I will call him Dan. He began his professional career as a teacher at his alma mater, St. Vincent St. Mary, and later at Stone Monroe Falls High School. And as a member, or as many of you know, his career actually began at Swenson's as a car hop when he was still in high school. Little did he know at that time that serving the people of Akron all those burgers would help prepare him for his full menu of challenges he would face serving as mayor. In 1999, he was elected Akron's first ward councilman, a position he held for 8 years. In 2007, the Summit County Democratic Party selected him as clerk of courts. He was a later elected president of the Ohio Clerk of Courts Association. He became the 62nd mayor of Akron in January 2016 and quickly announced the Blue Ribbon Task Force to help improve the community's financial health, leadership diversity, and quality of life. He is committed to improving efficiency, effectiveness, transparency, financial responsibility, rebuilding the city's neighborhoods, and population growth. And of course, along with everything else he's managing, the Ohio Canal Interceptor Tunnel, the largest construction project in Akron history. I know a little about construction. I've been impressed with Dan's quick learning curve and his ability to oversee the huge water quality project. Nonetheless, I doubt he expected his career would go down the drain so quickly. One of Dan's signature lines is that you gotta know when to lead, when to follow, and when to get out of the way. Getting out of the way will serve him well when he visits that construction site. Only for your safety, of course, Mayor. As a representative of the chamber, I have found him to be very open to new ideas and discussions about economic development in Akron. In fact, he and County Executive Eileen Shapiro have both agreed to meet with the chamber to discuss how we can ideally organize economic development activities by the city, the county, and the chamber to eliminate redundancy, leverage each other's strengths, and maximize results for our community. Dan Horrigan is passionate about the city he grew up in and does not intend to preside over anything less than its growth and prosperity. He and his wife, Deanna, have three beautiful daughters who are the fourth generation of the Horrigan family on North Hill. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming Akron Mayor Dan Horrigan.
Before I get started, two things. One, I'm the elected to mention yesterday, but I didn't know until early this morning. I want to thank Father Norm for giving the opening prayer. It was also his birthday yesterday, so let's say happy birthday to Father Norm. Thank you, Father Norm. Downright, I did spend part of my work career at Swenson's. There's a good part and a bad part. I think it's an excellent place to work. You did learn about customer service. The bad part is I do remember what most of you tipped. Thank you. Thank you, Don. And good afternoon. Don Taylor is not only the leader of the Greater Akron Chamber, one of the city's most important partners, also on a personal level, Don has extended himself into the business and civic life of Akron, and we have benefited from the entrepreneurial spirit he has shared with so many people. For that, we are all grateful. Thank you, Don. This year's State of the City is hosted by the Akron Roundtable, co-sponsored by the Greater Akron Chamber, Leadership Akron, and the Akron Kiwanis Club and the Rotary Club of Akron. My thanks to these organizations for working together to host this event. And let us thank the chefs, servers, laborers, management team here at the Knight Center for the continued hard work. Thank you. our city is on the verge of a renaissance, a time when we can create stronger and more stable neighborhoods and a robust economy that reaches all of us. And 12 months later, I believe we have taken major steps to make those promises a reality. In this past year, we have set the table for a new Akron, one that is poised to innovate and grow. Having said that, we are keenly aware of the challenges that we continue to face as we look to take our place among the best urban areas of the country. As I review some of our successes this past year, please note that this is a result of a hard-working team of leaders at City Hall in my cabinet, and the 1,800 employees who are dedicated to making Akron a great place to live and work. With the approval of voters last spring, we quickly formed the new Department of Human Resources to better manage the workforce that serves all of us every day. And we have worked to develop stronger partnerships with Akron City Council. It was very important to me to reset our relationship to move this city forward. They have joined me on numerous occasions in putting forth solutions for some of our most difficult problems. I'd like to ask Council President Mary McKeith and all the members of Akron City Council here to please stand and join me in recognizing their service to our community. Like John said, without the support and love of my family. I've been blessed to be married for 22 years to my wife, Deanna, three beautiful children. My sisters and my mom are here. My brother didn't want to come, but that's okay. But if you don't have that support at home, it really helps. It takes a lot for me. There's decompression places, and the home is where it is for us. We've made a home there, and we continue to we'll do that and see our children grow and stay here. And that's one of the whole focuses, is to try and do that. 2016 was an interesting year. I held 6 town halls, one in each different area of the city, and a youth town hall that brought together students from every one of Akron's high schools. I met with every senior class in the Akron Public Schools. I convened Akron's inaugural Health Equity Summit for leaders of health and social services, our faith community, our educators, and our residents, as promised. In June, we honored LeBron James with a party that 30,000 of you attended in downtown Akron. We designated a portion of Main Street King James Way after our hometown hero sealed the long overdue championship for Northeast Ohio, the first in 50 years. Thank you. Also went to the same high school, but that's a whole thing. On a more serious note, and in August, we said goodbye to our dear friend, Russ Pride, a great friend to many of us, and our county executive. We will all miss his leadership, his smile, and his uncanny wit. In November, we celebrated the election of Selma County's first female executive in Eileen Shapiro, who's with us today. Thank you, Eileen. Eileen is a very important partner for me and for the city. I look forward to seeing what we will achieve together. I have learned in 2016, after listening to the collective wisdom of all of our residents, our business leaders, and our children, is that we have an untapped reservoir of goodwill, an appreciation for our history, and a supply of energy that bodes well for our future. Those that live and work here want to see Akron grow and succeed. I believe they will give us the tools to meet their expectations. As you might expect, one of the first things that residents care most about is the massive $1.4 billion sewer project and its impact on utility bills. Even before I took the oath on New Year's Day in 2016, I made arrangements to meet with the EPA in Washington and reach out to the federal court that oversees the largest construction program in the history of our city. 12 months later, I can report to you substantial progress. Construction of new infrastructure is on time, and importantly, I can tell you that we've accomplished my early goal of seeing the total cost of the program reduced. In the past, year, work has been completed on 4 storage basins that will reduce the amount of untreated sewage flowing into our waterways by millions of gallons after heavy rain. By the end of all of the sewer projects, these are some numbers that you kind of have to get your hands around, 1.6 billion gallons of untreated sewage a year will be removed from our waterways. And that's the equivalent of over about 100,000 swimming pools on a yearly basis out of our rivers. So that, I think, is a tagline for an applause. The largest project of all is the construction of a mile-long tunnel under downtown. Our tunnel boring machine, named Rosie, is being built as we speak and will arrive for work by early this summer. As soon as she's on site, I will invite all of you, our school children, and the community to see this awe-inspiring machine up close. And in case you didn't know, Rosie is the name of a real person, Rose Mae Jacob, from Kenmore, who, with hundreds of other women, helped America win the Second World War by working in Akron's rubber factories. By working with the EPA, we've been able to cut $30 million from the cost estimate of the total project. And with the changes, we also get clean water benefits sooner, remove fewer trees, and eliminate destruction along the towpath trail. In fact, we have committed to replace every single tree removed during the sewer projects with 2 new trees. By refinancing long-term debt, we were able to save another $18 million over the life of the project. So, in my first year, we have cut the cost to the ratepayers by more than $50 million. As most of you know, and I realize this on a daily and a weekly basis, this is not nearly enough. We must continue to bring these costs down while seeking better financing options to pay for them. Another high priority for all of us is safety. We see the scourge of drugs and violence around the country, and here we are not immune. With regards to opiates and their replacement by heroin, often laced with fentanyl, Akron and Summit County have been at the center of this epidemic. In response, I directed our police department to ensure that our patrol cars carry the antidote, Narcan, and that police officers on the street were trained on how to use it. It has made a significant difference. And every day, we see our police officers and EMTs saving lives. I'd like to take a moment now to thank Akron's first responders for their continued commitment to bravely serve our citizens each and every day. Thank you. In 2017, Akron will establish quick response teams comprised of a police officer, a medic, and a treatment counselor who will reach out to those who have overdosed. They will offer treatment resources to the overdose victim and the family. And where this model has been successful, such as Hamilton County, the QRT has resulted in a 35% reduction in overdoses and an 80% success rate in getting people into treatment. As I said in my roundtable speech just a year ago, in 2 Akron zip codes, we have the worst infant mortality rates in the county and among the worst in the state of Ohio. In November, I convened a health equity summit that engaged healthcare leaders, social service agencies, government and faith leaders, citizen advocates to help us develop a plan for intervention. It is clear that the primary driver of inequity is the shocking amount of premature births here in Akron. Participants at the summit developed two recommendations. One, the need to define success and establish community-wide goals, and two, neighborhood-level engagement around premature. My assistant for education and health initiatives, Dr. Terry Albanese, will continue to lead our efforts, and I'm proud to announce, with the philanthropic support of Akron Children's Hospital, Summa Health, and Cleveland Clinic Akron General, this year I will hire a health equity ambassador to assist us in achieving measurable results for our moms and our babies. Please join me in thanking our hospital. Listen, the best antidote to crime and poor health is pretty well known. It's a job. And the pathway to jobs is also pretty well known. It's education. That's why much of my time this past year was spent in schools and meeting with local business leaders. Having taught the classroom for about 10 years, it's a subject I do know something about. As I traveled to Akron's high schools and I spoke with principals, administrators, teachers, and students, I came away knowing that our children, they are intelligent, they are well prepared, and the notion that our schools are failing is simply wrong. And it's far past time this perception gets changed. But even with all the good work being done, we cannot ignore the numerous independent reports which show a canyon-like gulf between the educational level of our residents and the skills needed to compete for available jobs. This skills gap threatens our region's ability to grow and attract new investment. According to data compiled by the Summit Education Initiative, there are roughly 74,000 adults living in our region with some college but no degree. That's almost 20% of the population. And if there's one achievement in 2016 that I am most proud of, is the relationship that the city has established with Stark State College to build a new downtown campus, which is a $12 million investment in Akron. Stark State will provide low-cost options for residents who seek to bridge the gap between their current skill level and the jobs that pay a living wage. And for those of you who don't know, there's a huge difference between minimum and living wage. It will also connect employers to the training and certifications that their workforce requires to expand. We've ended the drought in Akron of being one of the few Midwestern cities without an independent state-supported community college. And I'd like to acknowledge my partner in all of this, Dr. Kara Jones, President of Stark State College. Thank you. Many of the jobs of the 21st century will require advanced knowledge and a curious mind. And while we need to increase the opportunities for workforce training, we also need the innovation of a strong University of Akron. I'm a proud partner with the university and others on an innovation center right here in downtown. It's called Bits and Atoms. And this is a project that will construct a makerspace on Main Street, bringing together professional, student, and citizen entrepreneurs alike, a place where all innovators can simply bump into each other and create. In 2016, Bits and Atoms was awarded state and federal grants totaling over $3 million. And more often than not, cities like Akron are turning to their research university partners to jumpstart the local economy. Patent activity and the retention of those with advanced degrees are becoming key performance indicators for cities on the rise. That's why I will continue to seek, I have these in quotation marks, I will continue to seek unprecedented collaboration with the University of Akron. And I want to recognize my partner in those efforts, President Matt Wilson. to our region. But we need increased scale and a lot fewer silos for innovation to flourish once again. It's through investments in technology and innovation that will place Akron among the most forward-thinking cities in the country. If I've experienced, and this is a smiling one, if I've experienced any frustrations this year, and there have been a few, and I think the source of many of those frustrations is about half the people in this room, but that includes my kids too. If there's any frustration, I think it's in harnessing the collective resources, and Don mentioned this a little bit in the beginning, of the city, the county, the universities, the Greater Akron Chamber, and others in the area of economic development. The same reports that show our skills gap also reveal a stagnant local economy. My Blue Ribbon Task Force organized a special subcommittee to examine development efforts in and around the city, recommending that we take our strategies in a bold new direction. That's why today I am announcing the creation of the Akron Growth Council. The council will be made up of 8 to 10 individuals whom I will appoint to advise me and my team on nothing less than a transformation of the economic development ecosystem in our city. I've come to realize that the strategies that have been in place for the past 30 years are not necessarily those same strategies that will best serve us going forward. The job of the council will be to break us out of our old habits, help us generate a new strategic vision for securing outside investment, and to create an environment for new jobs with wages that will allow our residents to support their family. This will not be a strategic review that simply creates a plan to sit on a shelf, but rather a living, breathing process that seeks measurable improvements across the city. I have engaged our local and regional foundations in this effort, and I'd like to thank the Fund for Our Economic Future, GAR Foundation, Akron Community Foundation, Knight Foundation, and First Energy Foundation, who have all pledged their support. Thank you. As we build a great place to work, we must also create great places to live and play. A year ago, I promised that I would create the very first strategic plan for the largest job center in Akron, our downtown. With Susie Graham and the Downtown Akron Partnership, I have assembled a steering committee of 37 representatives of large and small businesses, finance, nonprofits, housing, tourism, and real estate. They have worked purposely and efficiently to publish 10 principles that will lead us in making decisions about downtown development. Our first success was identifying a new developer for the Civic Theater Block and a new developer for the hotel at Cascade Plaza. And we hope to see construction begin soon. Additionally, through the hard work of many, Akron has secured not one, but two nationally competitive grants to rejuvenate public spaces downtown. Reimagining the Civic Commons, a grant funded through the Knight and Kresge Foundation efforts, and the U.S. Department of Transportation Tiger Grant will together provide a $10 million boost to our urban core. I believe that we're going to grow from the core out, and as our downtown improves, so too must our neighborhoods, and we aim to tackle housing first. This month, I unveiled a comprehensive housing strategy, detailed in its analysis, and clear in its recommendations. We partnered with the Greater Ohio Policy Council to benchmark our plan against best practices, and I've commissioned the Reinvestment Fund to conduct a market analysis of all 200 micro neighborhoods in Akron. What this tells us is that in many ways, Akron is still recovering from the foreclosure crisis. Beyond all the challenges that vacant housing presents, a significant portion of our housing, quite simply, is not in good condition. It is not attractive to middle-class families. My strategy seeks to establish all of those conditions paramount for new and infill housing construction, rehabbing existing homes, and preserving all of our historic neighborhoods. And this is a quintessential situation where the rising tide does lift all ships. And as we implement my housing strategy, I firmly believe new and existing residents will benefit. As you can gather so far, I'm all about growth for this city. Growth in population, growth in education, and growth in jobs. And when you look at the history of our city, our biggest periods of growth have paralleled America's open-door policy for new immigrants. In the 19th century, we were mostly Irish and Germans. After the 19th century, mostly people from Eastern Europe. And I'll bet many of us in this room today have grandparents or great-grandparents who arrived here during one of America's great migration periods. Thank you. But this to me, this is what Akron is about. I got a text yesterday from a friend of mine who teaches in the Akron Public Schools. And he called to thank me for establishing the city as a welcoming city, which we have a history that goes back about 100 years of being a welcoming city. He said, I get to be a hero because I have a refugee boy, 11-year-old, that I get, and he's scared and he needs help, and I get to help him through all of this. To me, that's the Akron that's welcoming and opens its doors and looks at it and says, listen, these are the children that we're trying to help. To me, that's where we should be applauding ourselves, is that you get a random text from a friend that you've known for 20 years, and he's sitting there wanting to teach more refugees because he can help them. That's the Akron that I know. That's the Akron I want to see. What was true then is true today. We benefit from the diversity of our population and a welcoming policy that brings people to our city from other countries. These aren't democratic principles or republican principles. Conservative nor liberal, these are American principles based on our collective humanity for over 200 years. Unfortunately, what is happening today has happened before. And recently, I ran across this piece from the Akron Beacon Journal, and I'll just read part of it. No person of foreign birth who is a resident of Akron need fear an invasion of his personal or property rights. All foreign-born residents will be protected in Akron so as long as they go peaceably about their business. And the writer goes on, I urgently request that our people refrain from public discussion which might arouse personal feeling and maintain a calm attitude toward everyone without regard to nationality. That statement made by my predecessor, Mayor William J. Law, and he published it on the front page of Akron's two newspapers, April 3rd, 1917, 100 years ago, on the very same day that President Wilson asked for a declaration of war against Germany. When it comes to being a welcoming city, let's allow our history to be our guide. Every day, I'm energized to fight for every healthy baby, every graduate, and every Akron job. I am incredibly proud of our first year in office and the growth, rebirth, and the optimism we have worked so hard to cultivate together. But as I do look forward into this coming year and the years to come, I am struck by the reality that the decisions we make today have far-reaching and powerful consequences. While we continue to rise and meet the challenges of the present, we must also resolve to build a prosperous, healthy, and financially stable city for the generations that will follow. As I see it, the two most significant responsibilities that I have as mayor are first, to protect the health and safety of all citizens, and second, to remain a prudent and faithful steward of your public dollars. While I'm inspired by the potential and the momentum of Akron in this time of renaissance, I can't and won't sugarcoat where we are financially. We do have significant challenges, and we need to have an honest conversation about exactly where we are. While the overall state of the city is strong and getting stronger, the financial state of the city is at a crossroads. Here's an analogy I often use when talking about the city's finances. If the city's budget was that of a household, it might look something like this. We would be a middle-class family. Our household income has suffered in recent years. We're doing all we can to earn more. But, like many of our neighbors, we struggle to find the kind of work we had before the recession. We pay our bills, we pay them on time, every month with what we earn. But we are living nearly paycheck to paycheck. We have a mortgage, maybe two. Student loans to pay, several credit cards, nearly maxed out, and no real savings to speak of. We've cut back as much as we can over the years, but if we cut back much more, we will end up losing something very important to us, like tutoring for the kids, keeping our house safe and clean, or being able to donate to charities. We worry about things, like how do we send our kids to college, and what will we do if, God forbid, the furnace was to break. This is no way to live as a family, and quite frankly, no way to thrive as a city. And as I said last year, I am not comfortable, nor will I ever be, to just manage our decline, and none of us should be. Before I entered office, I appointed an experienced and diverse Blue Ribbon Task Force to look under the hood of our city government. The task force respectfully found that the city has several financial strengths, all of which I've seen firsthand every day. Among them, a very strong management team, a strong asset base, and clean audits. I have implemented many of the task force recommendations, including health benefits reform, partnerships to reduce city subsidies, and more effective revenue collection, and a critical review of city agreements and fee schedules. Listen, since 2008, the city has lost more than $86 million in income taxes, the result of unemployment and underemployment triggered by the Great Recession. Second, only to the loss of income tax has been the loss of fair tax sharing from the state of Ohio. According to the Independent Policy Matters Ohio report released last month, Akron lost $15 million a year in state revenue sharing from the elimination of the estate tax and reductions in local government fund, in the local government fund. The casino tax, no one's surprised, failed to fill the gap. And this equates to roughly a 50% reduction in state support to provide services and maintain operations critical to our residents. The majority of the state house is proud of saying they balanced their budget. And you know what? They did. But you have to ask yourself, at what cost? The state has abandoned an 80-year agreement with cities who supported the state sales tax and income tax in exchange for an agreement to invest a significant portion of those funds back into local communities. But now, as Akron, cities like Akron strive to re-energize their local economies and neighborhoods, the state has decided to keep those funds for itself. Even as a revenue-challenged city, we must continue to try and invest in our future. We can make no excuses, and quite frankly, I will not. Our safety forces deserve to have the best equipment. Our roads cannot continue to fall apart, and our neighborhoods cannot and will not be left behind. Two questions. What does this mean, and how do we move forward? First, I will continue to cut costs and implement efficiency measures that will prevent any unnecessary spending. Second, I will focus on preserving our most critical services, police, fire, EMTs, road repair, and infrastructure. These essential neighborhood services keep Akron safe and strong, and we cannot allow them to deteriorate further. Most importantly, I will go out into the community, as I have done since the beginning of my public service career, to hear what the people have to say and communicate our needs directly to them. Together, we must do what is needed to overcome the inherited challenges and chart a pathway towards a more secure financial future. I have full confidence we will do just that. Akron is known for being innovative and industrious, reinventing itself in the face of a changing landscape. We have enough energy, enthusiasm, and determination for a city 10 times our size. It will take all of that energy generated by our collective belief in Akron to ensure that we realize our full potential every single day. And while many of us in this room count ourselves among the converted, I've heard supporters and detractors whisper and sometimes even shout, "Hey, this all sounds great, but can any of this really happen in Akron?" Let me be clear. When people ask, why Akron? I say, and we must all say, why not Akron? Because if we don't believe in ourselves, no one else will. Why not Akron as a city where a new economic vision spurs local growth and attracts new investment? Why not Akron, a community where collaboration creates a vibrant, livable downtown? Why not Akron, a city that celebrates the arts, culture, and diversity? Why not Akron, a welcoming place where anyone can seek an education, a healthy start, or find their dream home? Years from now, when other cities look for a model of rebirth, someone will say, why not look to Akron? As Akron continues to evolve from its roots as an industrial powerhouse to a highly creative, innovative center of excellence, let us never forget our greatest asset has always remained constant. It's been our people. This resource, as fueled us in the past and will again, prove to be the catalyst going forward. And as I work together with you to embrace the challenges we all face and the opportunities on the horizon, the state of this city is like the faith, is like my faith in the people of Akron. It has never been stronger.
Where you can, as a young professional, take your dream and make it happen. We've been excited to kind of come alongside the other entrepreneurs that are doing the same thing.
Some blighted areas that are just ripe for greening, and a lot of people in place and excited to organize their community around greening those spaces. It's important to have a city that self-sustains so that they are able to care for each other and meet their own needs.
As a resident of Akron, clean, safe water is important to me as I consume it every day. Coming to work and helping to provide that for all of the residents of Akron and neighboring communities makes it very personal.
I think the people of Akron want to encourage diversity, sustainability, community. I think the people of Akron are very caring and compassionate and want to see the city grow.
I do feel like the people of Akron are different than people in other cities just because we're a little more rustic, we're kind. We definitely have a ton of tenacity. When we fall down, we get back up. We don't let a lot of things get to us. We just figure it out and make it happen. We're inspired by like everything, our history, what we are, what we have been, what we're on the road to becoming. You can show representation and love for your actual home or different things that only we know about. Inspiration comes from everybody and everything within the city.
One of the few things in life that you don't get to choose is where you're from. We lucked out if you're from Akron because it's a great place to be from. Akron has a little bit of everything. There's no shortage of stuff that you can throw yourself into and be proud of here.
Now I know exactly.
And there are also note cards at your table. Please raise your card if you want to submit a question that will be brought to the podium. Mayor, given where I work, the first question will be about leadership. So now that you've been in office over a year and as you reflect on the road ahead, what aspects of leadership stand out to you today more than ever?
To me, it's always been about, never been about victory laps, and that's something that I kind of learned from Russ also. It's about servant leadership too. We're not here to kind of look for the next position or whatever we're trying to do. I think it's, there are a lot of problems out there, a lot of opportunities. I think you get to the point where you solve one and then keep looking to solve another. I think that's what the community is demanding of us. And so that's what we need to do.
Great. The city just released a housing plan that includes tax abatements for residential construction. What levels of construction are you hoping will result from having that in place, and how do you expect it to impact that?
As Don Taylor mentioned, my first degree was in economics from Kent State. I think people respond to incentives, and I think for a long time we didn't have enough of an incentive to be able to fill that in there. I think we're at the right place at the right time now with a strategy that says, we need to be attractive to residents. We're trying to attract middle-class families. The housing portion is just one part of the whole part of it. So, but giving people that incentive to be able to build and move in, that's all part of it.
As a former educator, we have a high school junior who is putting you on the spot a little bit here with Why Not Akron. So they say, I'm a high school junior who is interested in going into engineering. I want to go to college, maybe in Massachusetts, California, or in Germany. What would you say to convince me to stay in Akron?
Why not Akron? it's a further conversation. You have one of the top-rated engineering schools in the country, right in our downtown. It's a longer conversation. If they want to contact our office, we'd be more than happy to try to convince them.
Great. We all know that the Inner Belt, running right alongside downtown, is undergoing a major transformation. A number of questions here about what you're hoping we'll be able to say about that area maybe in 5 or 10 years, and maybe some potential pathways you could take.
About the middle of last year, we convened kind of an internal team to look at the large pieces of property that we own, and the Inner Belt was one of them. We're kind of putting them into what sort of master plan do we want to see? To me, the Inner Belt and the 30 acres there is, I think, best used for mixed use, which is live, work, and play. And then as we get the construction done with MLK and Howard and get the access roads finished, I think we can finally start to concentrate on, you know, what may actually go there. Nothing concrete as of yet, but a lot of planning and vision going on, as we speak.
Right. You painted a sobering picture of the city's financial situation, given the loss of tax revenue and the disinvestment from other sources. There's a number of questions to this effect. I'll just put it on the table. Do you anticipate consideration of an income tax increase to put the city on stronger financial footing?
I said it 20 minutes ago when we said we need to have an honest conversation about where we are going as a city and how we maybe change that conversation a little bit. I can tell you this, if it was under consideration, or if we do consider it something, it's for police, fire, roads, EMTs, and infrastructure to build this city's base back up. I even said about 25 minutes ago during the speech that I've always taken the case and taken that message to the people and to get the collective wisdom and the feedback from our residents too, and I'll continue to do that.
Also, you mentioned downtown as a place that makes Akron a great place to live, work, and play. And we also have a question about the parks and environmental assets in the region, the National Park, the Metro Parks, the Towpath Trail. How do you see the city's parks working into this equation, and how do they play into the goal of growing Akron's population again?
That's a great question, which thanks to another project that we kicked off about 8 months ago, I asked the planning department to start to look at our city parks, where they're located, how much use they get, and how we can better connect to maybe the Towpath Trail or the Metro Parks, and how we connect those neighborhoods down that way. We have a lot of city parks. Some are active, some are not. So as it's more of a planning process to be able to get some of that done. But that's another, you know, case we'll have to take back out to the neighborhood. So, and to try to find out, you know, which ones are most active and how we best connect them so people can get around as well as they can.
So there's been a lot of perspective in the last year about Akron as a welcoming city, and a number of communities are also contemplating the concept of being a sanctuary city. How do you see these possibilities playing out in Akron?
Well, 2 points. One, our welcoming policy has been working. It's been working for about 150 years. Two, I think there's some confusion out there about illegal immigrants and refugees. Refugees are actually legal immigrants, and so they're legal to be here, and those who we are integrating into our society, and they're, you know, going to schools and getting jobs. That's what we want to do. We want to be a welcoming place. And the difference between being a welcoming and a sanctuary city, like I said, there's a lot of confusion out there about what people actually think that it should be and what it should not be. But the welcoming policy is working, and we've been able to grow because of it.
Well, the flood of questions makes me wish we had another hour here, but alas, our time is coming to a close. At Roundtable, our tradition is to ask a bit more of a lighthearted question at the end of the program. So with that in mind, you know, those rare moments you get to unwind, what are some of your favorite things to do when you have some time to yourself at Akron?
Rare moments, you said. I've made no secret that I do like to get out on the bike. I was out on last Friday. I like to cook. I really like to spend time with my family. And golf are pretty much the two or three decompression chambers where you get just to kind of relax a little bit. But It's all, everything works out well, let's put it that way. The community has treated me very well the first year and a half, and I expect nothing less. So it's good to decompress once in a while.
Thank you, Aaron. I do have one final question. As I ask this final question, I would like to invite Summit County Executive Eileen Shapiro and University of Akron President Matthew Wilson to come toward the stage. Mayor, what can you tell us about how the proceeds from today's State of the City address will be invested?
In the planning part of this, when my staff first sat down and we started to plan the State of the City, we said we had to find a place where we could direct the proceeds. And the very first thing that popped into my mind is how do we honor Russ Pry? How do we do something concrete for him? And knowing, and many people in this room knew him very, very well. I don't know if he would have really liked a building or a road, but I do know this. I loved kids and education and furthering their education. So establishing and endowing a scholarship with the proceeds from this State of the City and future State of the Cities, I think is as good a tribute that we can give to a great man who gave a lot to this community. So it's an honor, and I thank all of you.
Thank you, Mayor Horrigan. As to many of you, Russ Pry was a dear friend to me. Russ loved young people, and he always had time to meet with a young man or a young woman to talk about their future. He was a mentor, a friend, and a really wonderful sounding board. Russ was very grateful to the University of Akron for receiving a quality education, and he often talked about his days at law school. Several years ago, he taught a class, political science, and really enjoyed interacting with the students. Many days he spoke of actually teaching after his retirement. Today, with the help of Mayor Horrigan, President Wilson, we're going to continue helping young people with their education by establishing a scholarship that is befitting of Russ's memory at the University of Akron Law School. I am so proud. Go ahead if you want. You can clap. I am so proud to stand here today, along with many of Russ's supporters and friends in this room, to present a check in the amount of $50,000 from the Friends of Russ Pry, which will be the initial source of the endowment of the scholarship. This initial amount from the Friends of Russ Pry will ensure that each year, at a minimum, there will be $2,250 awarded to a student of the law school. And as contributions are made through continuing Mayor Horrigan's State of the City, and those of you in the community who would care to continue to contribute to this, that endowment will grow over the years. Russ believed in getting a good education, and he also believed in giving back to the youth in our community. And there is no better way to carry on his legacy than this scholarship that will help a young person each and every year get the same quality of education he received from his alma mater. Russ will be remembered for many things he did in this community. And now, thanks to all of you, he will live on in our hearts by continuing to help others as he did in life. Thank you all. Russ is smiling down at us today.
Thank you again, Eileen. On behalf of the thousands of graduates from the University of Akron School of Law, the University of Akron family, and the incoming students who will benefit from this wonderful and generous contribution, I want to thank you for this generous gift honoring our distinguished alumnus and our friend, Russ Pry. As you may or may not know, Russ received his Juris Doctor degree from the University of Akron School of Law in 1984. Using this degree from Akron Law, Russ enjoyed success as an attorney, a two-time Mogador Village Council member, chair of the Summit County Democratic Party, member of the Summit County Board of Elections, and for the last 9 years of his life, he served as Summit County Executive. Russ was known for his excellent character and service record. He was truly a leader, an advocate, a conciliator, and a friend to many. He was a dedicated and exemplary public servant, as well as a strong supporter of the University of Akron. In fact, the University of Akron was honored to recognize Russ with the Distinguished Alumni Award in 2014. We miss Russ Pry's steady hand in the university and his presence in the entire community. But we're encouraged to know that his legacy will live on and shape the lives of future legal professionals and community leaders through this generous gift and the establishment of this scholarship. The University of Akron, we're all about providing access to not only affordable education, but access to graduation. As you may have seen, we recently, this past week, rolled out something new called the Akron Guarantee Scholarship, that not only, like many private universities, guarantees the life of a scholarship, but this, unlike any other scholarship that I'm aware of, provides automatic upgrades to students once they hit 30 credits, 60 credits, and 90 credits. So that a senior at the University of Akron will have $3,500 more towards their education than when they started. With this endowment that we have, on behalf of Russ Pry, this is another contribution to the University of Akron students, and it helps support them to give them access to graduation, the opportunity to contribute to our society. And for that, we are indeed grateful. Today, you actually have the opportunity to contribute to this wonderful scholarship fund that today was announced and is in its infancy. On your table, if you're so inclined, there are envelopes where you can donate in memory and honor of Russell M. Pry to this wonderful scholarship. Thank you all for your support of the University of Akron. Thank you all for your support of this community. Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Eileen, for your servant leadership. For that, we are all truly grateful. Thank you.